people don't examine the meaning of the word exploitation. I think if you ask most people, they would say to be exploited is to have a low wage, whereas the real meaning of it is to have a tremendous discrepancy between what your services are worth and what you are paid.
In 1946, the major league owners had established a minimum salary of $5,000 a year. In 1966, in the midst of a decade dedicated to change, it had risen only $2,000. 2 months before the 1966 season began, Sandy Koufax and Don Drysdale demanded a raise from their owner, Walter O'Malley, insisting that he negotiate with them as a pair. Without their combined talents, they felt, the Dodgers were sure to end up in the cellar. They also insisted that the Dodgers deal with their agent, something new in baseball, not with them. An infuriated O'Malley refused. Baseball is an old-fashioned game with old-fashioned traditions, he said. And since the reserve clause barred their trying to play for anyone else, he resolved to wait them out. Finally, the pitchers were forced to negotiate for themselves, separately, and settled for considerably less than they had wanted. Without a union, even two of the game's greatest stars were forced to give in to management. On March 5th, 1966, the largely ceremonial and ineffective Major League Baseball Players Association created the full-time post of executive director and appointed to it a veteran labor organizer, Marvin Miller.
I grew up in Brooklyn, not very far from Ebbets Field, and I was a fan of the Brooklyn Dodgers from the earliest days I can remember. That ended first when I left Brooklyn, and second when shortly thereafter the Dodgers left Brooklyn.
Marvin Miller had spent most of his life in the labor movement, the International Association of Machinists, the United Automobile Workers, and for 16 years, the United Steelworkers.
Marvin Miller was probably the greatest thing that ever happened to baseball as far as the players are concerned. The moment that we found out that the owners didn't want Marvin Miller, he was our guy.
Tough, seasoned, and relentless, Miller rallied the players to the organization, then demanded that the club owners bargain collectively, provide improved pensions, raise minimum salaries.
When Marvin started, the owners obviously weren't prepared to fall in love with him. And as a matter of fact, the more they saw of Marvin, the less prepared to fall in love with him they were. He obviously did a great job for the players as far as getting them salaries. I'm not sure on balance that he was good for baseball.
Sports writers following the developing conflict were, for the most part, uninterested in the complicated labor issues, making them active agents against Miller and the union. For years, the public and even some players distrusted him. But the battle over who would control the game had begun. The showdown ahead would be over the century-old reserve clause, which bound each player to his club for life, and which to many smacked of slavery.
Baseball cannot be termed slavery anymore. That description would certainly fit the baseball of earlier in this century. How far you want to extend it into this century is debatable, but it once was a plantation, it is not anymore.